If you have your Bibles this morning, would encourage you to please follow in God's Word. I'm going to be reading more scriptures than I normally do. The subject that's on my heart is following Jesus. The importance of us following Jesus in every way in our lives. I encourage you to open your Bibles to Matthew chapter 3. I want to read verses 1 and 2 there. And then we'll come down to verse 17 and read several verses there in Matthew chapter 4. Matthew chapter 3, please notice in verses 1 and 2, the Word of God says, "In those days came John the Baptist preaching in the wilderness of Judea and saying, Repent ye, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." So John the Baptist preached, "Repent ye, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." Matthew chapter 4, verse 17. "From that time Jesus began to preach and to say, Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." John the Baptist, Jesus Christ, the 12 apostles, 70 disciples, every New Testament preacher preached on this same subject, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is, what are the last two words there?
Amen.
At hand. Now, when something is at hand, it's something that's close by. Sometimes it's something that you can touch or something that you can feel, but at the very least, it's something that's close. It's at hand. It's near. The Word of God says here that John the Baptist and Jesus, and we'll read later about others, that said, "Repent ye, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." This kingdom of heaven is different than the eternal heaven. The eternal heaven is where all the family of God will one day be forever, and we will be in the eternal heaven because of the blood of Jesus Christ. The Word of God tells us that our eternal salvation is not of our works, not by our works, not according to our works. So our works do not get us into the eternal heaven. But then when you begin to read and study about the kingdom of heaven, you find that our works are essential to enter the kingdom of heaven. One of the works that he gives us here in Matthew chapter 3, 2 and 4, 17, he says, "Repent ye." Now, what does the word repent? That's something that's absolutely necessary if you're going to enter the kingdom of heaven. And the kingdom of heaven is defined, let me give you a couple of definitions from the scriptures. I get very uncomfortable when people start talking about they think something is this or they think something is that. Here's what the Bible says about the kingdom of heaven or the kingdom of God. Here's how the Bible defines the kingdom of heaven or the kingdom of God. Those two phrases are used interchangeably in the scriptures. Kingdom of heaven, kingdom of God. When Matthew is writing, he typically uses the term kingdom of heaven. Luke will record the same day in the life of Jesus, and Luke says that Jesus said, kingdom of God. So the phrases kingdom of heaven and kingdom of God are used interchangeably in the scriptures. Multitude of scriptures that show that. The Word of God says in Romans chapter 14 and verse 17 that the kingdom of heaven or the kingdom of God is not meat and drink, but righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Ghost. That whenever you can feel that righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Ghost, you're in the what? You're in the kingdom of heaven. You're having intimate fellowship with God. After Jesus and the 12 apostles and all the disciples were preaching about the kingdom of heaven, the Pharisees demanded Jesus to tell them in Luke 17, verses 20 and 21, they demanded Jesus to tell them, where is the kingdom of heaven? And Jesus says that you will say neither here nor there, but lo, the kingdom of God is where? The kingdom of heaven or the kingdom of God is within you. Now the definition from Romans 14:17 is it's that righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Ghost. And then it's described as being within you. And we as the people of God, we need to know that we have the eternal heaven to look forward to when we die. But we also need to thank God that we have the kingdom of heaven while we live right here on this earth. I look forward to being with God and seeing Him face to face in the eternal heaven. I look forward to Him taking me to eternal heaven. The Word of God talks about God coming down and dwelling with us here in the kingdom of heaven. And so John the Baptist and Jesus say, repent. Now what does repent mean? Is that when you feel sorry for sin, feel sorry about the sins in your life? Or is it feeling more? Is it more than just feeling sorry about sin? Repent is far more than remorse. Remorse is when you feel bad about sin. Repent is when you feel so bad about sin that you turn away from sin. That's what repent means. It means to turn around and go in a different direction. It means to turn away from the world and turn towards Jesus. It means turn away from darkness and go towards light. It means get away from death and go towards life. Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is what? At hand. Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Now listen to verse 18, 19. Let me read three or four verses here. After Jesus said, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. And Jesus, walking by the Sea of Galilee, saw two brethren, Simon called Peter, and Andrew his brother, casting a net into the sea, for they were fishers. Now listen carefully to verse 19. This is the main verse that's on my heart. And he said unto them, follow me, and I will make you fishers of men. I will make you fishers of men. Now, Brother Jim was telling us about Brother Matt catching quite a few fish yesterday and told us about him catching fish. And I want you to know that fishing is a lot of fun if you enjoy fishing. Fishing is a lot of fun if you're catching fish, to me. I like to catch fish. I don't just like to go and sit and catch nothing. But Jesus is teaching these men who were fishermen that there's something far greater and a greater pleasure and a greater joy than catching fish, and that's catching men. That's whenever we as a people of God are following Jesus, and we as a people of God, when we follow Jesus, we will attract others that also want to follow Jesus. And that's how you begin to catch men, is by letting your light shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven. That's part of the way that we catch men. That's part of the way we become fishers of men. But Jesus says right here, you don't have to concentrate on all the different ways to catch men. You concentrate on one thing, and then Jesus says, and then I will make you fishers of men. What's the one thing he says that you need to concentrate on?
Make you.
Follow me. He said what? Follow me, and I will make you fishers of men. Who will make us fishers of men? Jesus will make us fishers of men. If we follow him, he, Jesus, will make us fishers of men. Now, if we're not catching men, if men are not getting closer to Jesus, then it's essential that we begin to understand. I'm talking about, because of your life, people ought to be getting closer to Jesus. And if people are not being converted, and people are not repenting, and people are not getting closer to God because of your life, then you're not, what's the two words? You're not
following
Jesus. That's right. Because there's a promise here. Jesus cannot lie. Jesus says, follow me, and I will make you fishers of men. Now come down to the next verse 20. And they straightway left their nets and followed him. who were the two that he just spoke about that just left their nets and followed Peter and his brother. What was his brother's name? Andrew. Peter and Andrew left their nets and followed him. Did Peter and Andrew become fishers of men? Yes. Was that their goal, to become fishers of men? No. What was their goal? Their goal was to follow Jesus and then leave the rest in God's hands, brethren. Just follow Jesus and he will take care of the rest. He will make you fishers of men. Verse 21 says, and going on from thence, he saw other two brethren, James the son of Zebedee and John his brother, in a ship with Zebedee his father, mending their nets. And he called them, and they immediately left the ship and their father and followed him. So what did these four men who were disciples of Jesus, what did these four men do? They followed Jesus. But before they could follow Jesus, what did they have to do? They had to leave their nets. They had to leave something that they were occupied. There was something that was occupying all of their time, and Jesus called them to leave that occupation and to begin to follow him. And they began to follow Jesus, and they then were made fishers of men by Jesus Christ. Now, I want us to, from this point forward, to primarily, we're going to come back, Lord willing, we're going to come back to being a fisher of men. We're going to come back to that. But I want us to think about following Jesus. What are some things that have to be in my life, in your life, if we're following Jesus?
Studying the Word.
Okay, we have to be studying the Word of God. Now, let's go through the book of Matthew. And this is the reason I say we're going to do more reading than normal. I want us to just go through the book of Matthew, and we're just going to hit some high points in Matthew about what Jesus did. So if we're going to follow Jesus, we've got to do these things that Jesus did. Let's see, what did Matthew record that Jesus did? Right after he called these four men, what was the first thing he did? Matthew chapter 4, listen please to verse 23. And Jesus went about all Galilee, teaching in their synagogues and preaching the gospel of the what?
Kingdom.
Preaching the gospel of the kingdom and healing all manner of sickness and all manner of disease among the people. I want you to know, he went teaching in the synagogues and he went preaching about the kingdom. I'll tell you, brethren, that one of the most important things that you must do if you're going to follow Jesus is you must do what Brother David said. You have to read and study the Word of God. You have to know what the Word of God says about the Word of God. You need to know what, you can't teach people something you don't know. How many of you could teach some trigonometry? Well, let me go higher. How many of you could teach calculus right now? How many of you could teach calculus, all right? Brother Jim, and got one little 4-year-old on the front row, says he can teach calculus. So there's two that say they can teach calculus, but probably the rest of us couldn't teach calculus right now. Mike could if we had some refreshing done, but I couldn't right now. But my point is this: if you don't know the Word of God, you can't share that with other people.
Amen.
If you're not reading and studying the Word of God, then you can't teach other people the Word of God. If you don't know what the Word of God says about the kingdom of heaven, which is what everybody in the New Testament was teaching about, if you don't know about that, you can't teach the truth about that. Now, you can teach something about it and teach error. The important thing is that we teach truth. Jesus only taught truth. He never taught anything except truth. If you're going to follow Jesus, you must follow his word. If you're going to follow Jesus, you must be teaching other people what the Word of God says. And so when Jesus went about teaching, what did he teach about? According to Matthew 4:23, what did he teach? Teaching in their synagogues and preaching the what? The gospel of the kingdom, the good news about the kingdom of heaven or the kingdom of God. Why is this good news? I'll tell you one reason the gospel of the kingdom of heaven or kingdom of God is such good news to me is I hear so many of God's children say, oh, I just look forward to one day going home to be with God. I look forward to one day dying and seeing the Lord. Well, I'll tell you, brethren, I look forward to that, but that's not what my focus is on here in this world. My focus is on walking with Jesus every day, talking with Jesus, being His friend, Him saying, well done, right now, well done. I want Jesus to be pleased with my life every day. At the close of the day, I want Him to say, as I'm laying in bed, you know, some people think in Matthew 25, when the Word of God says there that Jesus said to the five and the two talent servants, that they had taken those talents and they had worked, and they're going to be rewarded for their works. And that reward for their works is in the what? I couldn't hear half of you. That reward for their works is in which heaven? It's in the kingdom of heaven. All rewards for works are here in this world. Jesus is the one that gets us into eternal heaven, and our rewards for works are in the kingdom of heaven. And Jesus says to the five and the two talent servants in Matthew chapter 25, and by the way, that parable and every parable begins by saying, the kingdom of heaven is like, and then it gives you a parable. And in that parable, the five and the two talent servants, they had worked with those five talents and produced what? The five-talent servant. He produced five more talents. And the two-talent servant worked with his talents. And what did he produce? He produced two more talents. And what did the Lord say? Well done. Well done. Is that works? Is that works and obedience?
Yes.
Well done, thou good and faithful servant. Thou hast been faithful over a few things. I will make thee ruler over many things. Now listen carefully. Enter thou into the... Somebody fill in the blank. Enter thou into the joy of thy Lord. You remember that? That's what he said to the five and two talent servant. Enter thou into the joy of thy Lord. What is the kingdom of heaven? It's righteousness and peace and what?
Joy.
And that five and two talent servant, because of their good works, because of their obedience, because their Lord was pleased with their service, they entered into the kingdom of heaven. Very good. Now, you need to know about the kingdom of heaven. You need to teach about the kingdom. Did Jesus teach and talk a lot about the kingdom of heaven? Well, let's see in Matthew 5. What did Jesus teach about in Matthew 5? Look at verse 3, the Sermon on the Mount. Matthew 5, 6, and 7 is the Sermon on the Mount. Let's see Him teaching about the kingdom of heaven here. Matthew 5, beginning in verse 3, the Word of God says, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the what? Theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Come down to verse 10. Verse 10 says, blessed are they which are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the what?
Amen.
The kingdom of heaven. Come to Matthew chapter 6. Matthew 6, verses 9 and 10. Matthew 6, verse 9. We prayed this morning. The Word of God gives us an example prayer. Jesus says in Matthew 6, 9, after this manner, therefore, pray ye, our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom, what?
Come.
Thy kingdom come. Thy kingdom, what?
Come.
Well, what does that mean, thy kingdom come? Are we going to go up, or is it going to come down? The kingdom comes down and dwells with us here. And so we're to pray, thy kingdom come. And then in verse 13 he says, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Come down to verse 33, Matthew 6, verse 33. The Word of God says, but seek ye first the what? But seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. Everything you need will be provided if you seek first the kingdom of heaven. You see, what do we have a tendency to do? If you're going to give, when do you typically give to the Lord? If you got something, what? Give me two words. Many people, when they give, they give what's left over. But what are you supposed to give? You're supposed to give the first fruits. And the same thing's true when it comes to the kingdom of heaven. They, if they have a little extra time sometime, they may seek first, or not seek first, but they may seek last the kingdom of heaven. But the command from Jesus is, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. Come down to Matthew chapter 7, verse 21. What do you have to do to enter the kingdom of heaven? The answer is in Matthew 7, 21. Jesus says, not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father, which is in heaven. Do you have to do the will of the Father? Do you have to do good works to enter? Now here's a trick question. Do your good works get you into the eternal heaven?
No.
But do your good works get you into the kingdom of heaven?
Yes.
Yes. Big difference. Now, turn with me in your Bibles to Matthew chapter 10. So far, all we've done is just look at following Jesus and what he taught in the Sermon on the Mount. But let's see what he told his apostles to teach. He chooses, in Matthew chapter 10, he chooses 12 apostles. And I'm not going to name all of them right now. They're listed there in the first four verses. And then verse 5 says, Matthew 10 verse 5, these 12 Jesus sent forth and commanded them, saying, go not into the way of the Gentiles, and into any city of the Samaritans enter ye not, but go rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel, and as ye go, preach, saying what? The kingdom of heaven is what?
At hand.
So what did John the Baptist preach? Repent ye for the kingdom. What did Jesus preach? Repent. What did the 12 apostles preach? Same thing. And if you were to turn to Luke chapter 10, Jesus chose 70 disciples in Luke 10, and he sent those 70 disciples out, and Luke chapter 10 verse 9 told them to go and preach about this same heaven which God has prepared for his obedient children. Now listen carefully. Which God has prepared for his what?
Obedient
children. Do you know what the high life is? The high life. You know what the abundant life is? It's in the kingdom of heaven. That's right. That's the high life. It doesn't get any better than that. And the scripture says this in Matthew 7, 13, 14. Straight is the gate, and narrow is the way that leadeth unto what?
Life.
Now what is that life? That's the key. Watch. Straight is the gate, narrow is the way that leadeth unto life, and fill in the blank.
Few
there be that find it. Few there be that find it. Few. Are there only going to be a few people in eternal heaven? No, the Bible says, there as the sands of the seashore, there's the stars of heaven, there's the dust of the earth, a number of people so great that no man can number out of every nation, kindred, tongue, family, and tribe. There is a multitude of people that will be in eternal heaven, but there are few of God's children that follow God and serve God, and those are the ones that enter the what? The only ones that enter the kingdom of heaven are those who follow what? And I'm going to rephrase that. The only ones that enter the kingdom of heaven are those who follow who?
Jesus.
They follow Jesus. Follow Jesus. And you'll be in the what? In the kingdom of heaven. Turn to Matthew chapter 16 now. Matthew chapter 16. Beginning in verse 24. Matthew chapter 16, beginning in verse 24. Now please, brethren, go home and study these scriptures and see if these things are so. Be a Berean. The word of God says that the saints at Berea were more noble than those at Thessalonica because they received the word with all readiness of mind, and then they searched the scriptures whether those things are so or not. So I encourage every one of you, you go search the scriptures. You go see, is this what the Bible is saying or not? In Matthew chapter 16, beginning in verse 24, the word of God says, then said Jesus unto his disciples, if any man will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and Follow me. What did Peter and Andrew have to do? Let's take the two words, denying yourself. What did Peter and Andrew have to do? Deny themselves. How did they deny themselves? Yes, they left their nets. They were professional fishermen. I venture to say they were the best fishermen there were anywhere. Unless it was James and John, because their daddy was a good fisherman too. And James and John were the next ones he chose, and they were good fishermen, and they left their nets, and they left everything, and they followed Jesus. Are you going to have to leave some things and some people in this world if you're going to follow Jesus?
Yes.
You cannot be going around drinking and getting drunk and having parties and living ungodly. You cannot go around and do those kinds of things and follow Jesus. If you're not going to be willing to give up the things of this world, the Bible tells us, love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. The Word of God says, whosoever will be a friend of the world is the enemy of God. If my desire is to have people as my friends, if that's my number one desire, if that's my goal, to please people, I can't please God. If my desire is to be their friend more than to be the friend of God, I can't be a disciple of Jesus Christ. I have to deny myself and take up my cross and, what does he say in the last part of verse 24? Matthew 16, 24, he says, deny yourselves and take up your cross and follow me. I'm glad to tell you, you don't have to follow me, except as I follow Christ. See, the Apostle Paul makes that statement in, I think it's 1 Corinthians 11, 1. The Apostle Paul said, follow me as I follow Christ. And that's, as far as you children following your parents, you follow them as long as they're following Christ. And all of you church members, you only follow me as long as I'm following Christ. And when I stop following Christ, and when I stop preaching the Word of God, then you stop following me and you get you a different pastor. It's your responsibility to be sure that I try to follow Jesus. The Word of God says in verse 25, after he says, deny yourself, take up your cross and follow me, he says, for whosoever will save his life shall lose it. If you're going to try to hold on to this natural life, you're going to lose that abundant life. Whosoever shall save his life will lose it. And whosoever will lose his life for my sake shall find it. Find what? That abundant life that he mentioned in Matthew 7, 13 and 14. For what is a man profited if he shall gain the whole world and lose his own soul? Or what shall a man give in exchange for his soul? For the Son of Man, now listen carefully to 27 and 28. This is not talking about the end of the time world. If you'll look at it carefully, you'll see this cannot be talking about the end of the time world. Jesus says, for the Son of Man shall come in the glory of his Father with his angels, and then he shall reward every man according to his works. He's going to come and reward every man according to his what? Every man according to his works. Verily, I say unto you, there be some standing here which shall not taste of death till they see the Son of Man coming in his what? In his kingdom. I'll tell you, brethren, Jesus was speaking to a multitude of people there, and he says, there be some of you standing here which shall not taste of death till you see the Son of Man coming in his kingdom. Has Jesus come in his kingdom? Amen. Yes, he has, absolutely. And that brings great joy to my heart. I'll tell you who's on his throne today. I'll tell you who's ruling this world today. I'll tell you the most powerful government today is not the government of the United States. The most powerful government is the government of Jesus Christ. The most powerful governor, the most powerful leader is not Trump or Pence or anyone else. It's Jesus Christ. He's the leader. And we need to follow Jesus. I want us to begin, well, let me give you one more way to follow Jesus. Matthew 18. Matthew chapter 18. The scripture says, at the same time came the disciples unto Jesus, saying, who is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven? Now, did they know the kingdom of heaven was there? Did they know the kingdom of heaven was there?
Yes.
Who is, not who is going to be, who is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven? Jesus called a little, now who did Peter, I think Peter was talking there, it doesn't say that. Who is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven? Can't you just picture Peter walking up to Jesus? Jesus, I just want you to tell everybody who's the greatest in the kingdom of heaven. Who do you think Peter thought was the greatest in the kingdom of heaven?
Peter.
I think Peter thought Peter was the greatest in the kingdom of heaven. Might not have been that way. But they asked him, who is the greatest in the kingdom? And Jesus called a little child unto him and set him in the midst of them and said, verily I say unto you, except ye, pronoun ye is referring to whom? Okay, the disciples is the way it's called in this verse, probably the apostles. The disciples, all of the disciples were all of the apostles were disciples, but not all disciples were apostles. I'm not going to try to go there right now, but the disciples asked him, who's the greatest in the kingdom of heaven? Verse 3 says, verily I say unto you, except ye be converted, except ye, unless you disciples, be converted and become as little children, ye shall not enter into the kingdom of heaven. What was the one thing that was keeping the disciples out of the kingdom of heaven at this point in time? Give me one word, P-R-I-D-E. Pride. Which one of us is the greatest? And Jesus says, none of you are even in the kingdom. And unless you're converted, you can't enter the kingdom of heaven. So what's the one thing he's saying you have to have? The next verse he says, whosoever therefore shall, what are the next two words? Whosoever therefore shall humble himself as this little child, the same is greatest in the kingdom of heaven. What do you have to do if you're going to be in the kingdom of heaven? You have to humble yourself. Let's go back now and think. What's the text that we're looking at? We're going to continue, Lord willing, tonight. Two-word text. What is it?
Follow me.
Follow me. And then the rest of that verse says, and I will make you what? Fishers of men. Okay, now the first thing we're talking about that you have to do to follow Jesus is you have to know the Word of God and you have to teach other people the Word of God. You have to teach them. That's what Jesus. Didn't Jesus go everywhere he went? He taught people the Word of God. Second thing he tells us now is you have to deny yourself and take up your cross and follow Christ. And now he tells you have to humble yourself. You cannot be in the kingdom of heaven without humility. And let me say why that's so important. Because when you go to church Sunday morning, Sunday night, and Wednesday night, and somebody doesn't come Sunday night and Wednesday night, what does proud you sometimes think?
That they ought to be here and I'm here. Yeah.
That's right. I'm here. Why couldn't they be here? Now, all of us ought to be here. Don't misunderstand what I'm saying. But I am saying those of you that are here Sunday morning, Sunday night, and Wednesday night, those that are studying your Bible every day, those that are walking the way the Word of God says to walk, you better be careful or you'll get full of pride and you will be out of what? You'll be out of the kingdom of heaven. Jesus isn't going to have fellowship with you when you've got vain pride. Follow Jesus. Did Jesus have vain pride?
No.
No. He humbled himself. You can go home and read Philippians chapter 2, verses 5 through 11, and read step by step how Jesus humbled himself. Humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God, and he shall what? Lift you up into what? the kingdom of heaven. May God bless His word to our hearts is my prayer for Christ's sake.
Amen. Baby.